pocket to buy some juice. You gotta bring your own bags and you learn to reduce your waste. We gotta learn to reduce. And if your brother or your sister's got some cool clothes, you could try them on before you buy some more of those. Reuse. We gotta learn to reuse. And if the first two R's don't work out, and if you gotta make some trash, well, don't throw it out. Recycle. We gotta learn to recycle. We gotta learn to reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle. Reduce, reuse, recycle.
Building Green is supported by Barta.
Good morning and welcome to Building Green on BCTV. I am actually live on September 26th at just a little bit before 10. Most of the program today will be we will be looking at a tape. The topic for today is, climate change in Italy, building green in Italy, sustainability in Italy, what Italians are doing. That's pretty much what you're going to hear talked about in the interview. The guests that we will be seeing for the bulk of the program are, through the magic of Skype, are Marco Caponigro and Mariarosaria Ritonnaro. Marco is a consultant in the energy sector. He's an economist who works in the energy sector, and he works both in Italy, throughout Europe, and even abroad. And I know he makes frequent trips to Egypt, among other places. And Mariarosaria is an architect, and so they bring a combination of familiarity with the subject. They live in Modena, a city in Emilia-Romagna, which is between Florence and Milan, if you know Italy, a city of about 100,000 people in north-central Italy. Before we get to the interview, just want to make a few additional introductory comments. My wife and I spent several weeks in Italy this past summer, both as vacation and visiting relatives, one of whom happens to be Marco, who is my cousin's grandson. And he and Mariarosaria are husband and wife. One thing that became readily apparent as we traveled around Italy was the proliferation of solar panels on rooftops, particularly in the north central area where we were and throughout the parts of Italy we visited, and then the windmill arrays that we noticed in the south. And the solar panels, I mean, it's not just on houses, they were on residential structures, they were on multifamily buildings, they were on factory buildings, they were on schools, they were on firehouses, wineries. I'll talk about it next month. We even visited one winery that is 100% powered by its solar array. Even a cemetery that has a solar panel, an array of solar panels integrated into the cemetery itself. And next month we'll see some photographs of that. So you see these, you can't help but see these at every turn. It's not just an occasional panel. And so one can't help but wonder why is this? Why is it so much, why are there so many more installations in Europe that you'd see, or in Italy that you'd see, than one would see driving around similar areas in Pennsylvania or most of the U.S.? So what struck me, having worked in that arena for a long time, is that there must be some kind of financial incentive and or coupled with public policy. And since this is an area that both Mariarosaria and Marco are familiar with, I thought, well, let's try to arrange an interview with them, which is what you're about to see. As I said, we'll come back to this topic next month. Our initial idea was to fold the interview into a program, but they had so many good and useful things to say regarding these questions of how is it that this is getting done in Italy, a country with severe financial problems. I mean, we say here we can't afford to do it. Well, they've got issues as bad, if not worse, than us. So in spite of that, they're managing to get it done. So hopefully the interview will shed some light on that for all of us. But anyway, so because of the length of the interview, we've decided to break this into two programs. So this month is going to be the interview. Next month, we'll come back to this topic and talk a little bit about some of the, provide you with some information, some comparisons between Pennsylvania in particular and Italy. And I have a bunch of photographs that we can look at next month. So now we'll get we'll turn to the interview. It starts a little abruptly, but we cut out the beginning introduction, which I just made, and I hope you'll enjoy it. And I'll be back at the end just to make a few wrap up comments. Okay, so when I introduced this program earlier, I said that I observed countless solar and wind installations when I was in Italy last summer. And I was left with the impression that there must be some kind of incentives, public policy and financial incentives at play in Italy. So my first question is, is that true? Is that an accurate presumption? And if that's the case, what are the governments at different levels, the provincial, regional, the national, and including the European Union, what have they done to encourage a move towards renewable energy? So either one of you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. It will be nice to say that Italy, as member of the European Union, in the last 15 years, let's say we can say also 20, has seen a very change of the market, of the power and of the energy sector itself. It's important to fix this frame in order to provide a precise answer. This change put an obligation to reach some targets on renewable. And these targets include also a certain share of solar photovoltaic. Then when it started 10 years ago, there were approximately less than 200 megawatt installations in Italy. While today, probably we are reaching the number of 18 gigawatt power of installed of solar power. How it has been possible? Okay, it has been possible through a number of reasons. And one of these, of course, it was incentives. Financial incentives that were related essentially to boost the market, to let the market to grow, but because at that time the cost of 1 kilowatt installed was around 7,500 euro. We can say approximately it was probably $8,000-$9,000 for 1 kilowatt at that time, because the market was just at the beginning. And then all European countries were pushing in such a way. There were incentives in Germany, there were incentives in other countries in going to let the PV going down and to save a depreciation of the fixed cost that bring the cost down till today that probably it's for utility scale investments, it's around 1,000, we can say sometimes a little bit less. It depends from the dimension. Maybe for, let's say, rooftop demand scale, we are around 1,500 euro.
Rooftop installation.
Nowadays, after five cycle of incentives direct to the installation distance, the incentives as, let's say, essentially has gone out on PV. We have more, let's say, limited kind of other things, but not, let's say, this big incentives on the solar and also on wind. It has been essentially, it has gone away. It's important to say that this incentive was linked to the bill. It was included in a share of the bill, our share of the bill as distribution cost, transmission cost, measurement cost of the energy, and general cost, in which there are included also the cost of incentives.
And those incentives, so they have been provided by the different countries, the governments, the national governments, or have some of those come from the EU itself, the incentives you just spoke of?
The obligation was coming from EU, that it means also from the Italian government, because, I mean, EU decisions are taken by the Council of European Union, right, in which Italy is present and express its will.
So,
but the incentives were coming from the bill of everyone, because as a share in the general cost, as also the quota related about incentive for PV and for the other things.
And when you say it comes from the bill, you mean the
electricity bill.
The electricity bill, yeah, okay. Right. Okay, yeah, so there have been incentives, and that's partly what is responsible for some of those changes. Go ahead. Continue.
Yeah. Sorry, Bill. This about incentives on, let's say, solar, but the type of incentives that have been included in Italy are pretty different, not only in Italy, also in other countries. I can say about depreciation. Want me to say defiscalization?
Yes, another incentive was not only about energy, strictly talking about PV or wind, but also, for instance, if I wanted to restore my house, I can have some incentives also for insulations or for some kinds of action, like, I don't know, change the windows in order to have a better transmission in the building.
Right.
So also that was really important.
So that the energy consumption and thereby the cost would come down by improving the buildings. And so the incentive was that there would be a subsidy to do those improvements. Is that how I understand it? Yeah.
They introduced 10 years ago, more or less, the classes of the buildings. So you have class A, B, C, and you can see also when you are buying a house, what kind of energy class the building is. So if you have a class G, which is the lowest class, you can imagine to do some restoration to improve the energy class. And this also was really important in order to provide new incentives and to also to promote the market, because a lot also of construction companies started to specialize in this field. So this move a market in a certain way.
That's very interesting, this sort of class of buildings, because we've lost the image. Are you still there? Are you going to show something? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
This is an example of classes.
Okay.
The G is the lowest.
Uh-huh.
And the top is the one that has better
range. The lowest cost in what regard? G would be?
About the cost.
Which costs?
Allora, about the cost. Let's say that.
The class of the cost.
The cost.
You say cost? Bill?
Yes.
Cost or class?
No, you say, okay, these are the classes, not the cost. Le classe, okay.
And they have a standard range of consumption.
And so when one goes to purchase a building, that building would have one of these ratings.
Yes, now it's mandatory. Yes.
Uh-huh. So some someone
rent an apartment.
Yes, each apartment.
If you want to, I don't know, to rent an apartment, you have to declare and to communicate the class of the building or the single unit, the single house unit.
So one would from that conclude that a building with an A rating would bring a higher price because it's more valuable because the energy consumption is less. Is that right?
But of course you will also have some advantage because you have less consumption. So you can buy it, but it will be more expensive.
Right, but
of course the consumption will be lower. Mm-hmm. So.
No. And did you say there were incentives then if you were to buy a building at the G level, the G class, that there would be incentives for improving it? You would get subsidy to make energy retrofits, as we say.
Yes, there are some incentives, so you can...
The way it works in terms of defiscalization,
taxation.
Yeah, how do you have a tax credit in order to make the investment?
Improve
you gain this tax credit in a certain number of years.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It was a number, now it is larger. But I mean, this push not only one single unit to make the investment, but an entire building with there are probably, you know, it's in Italy that we have a lot of the buildings with several people living. I mean,
sure.
You have also a certain number of small villa that is a, let's say, self-independent house.
Mm-hmm.
But more of the case, you have buildings. Yeah, you have condominiums.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then you need to
restore the whole building.
And this is very helpful because many people, someone will have the money in order to restore the house. Some others maybe they don't have. So the fact that you have a tax credit is very, very generous.
And in any way,
I mean, it's also a very intelligent approach because in a certain way, if the government will, let's say, will win anyway, because if you didn't have this type of tax credit, many people will not do the investment.
Exactly. And it's a constant struggle in this country to win that argument. that's very interesting. I had no idea that existed in terms of buildings.
It is pretty familiar. The first one we are starting, they have in Germany, it was KfW. It's a national institutional bank, let's say a public bank. And then it was spread out all around Europe that it was the idea. Now it's becoming very, very, very familiar. But the fact that they saw the success, the point is that it's a medium-term policy because obliged to stop the nation, not to stop, to block a certain amount of revenue in the public budget.
It's a block. You mean say block? You mean set aside a certain amount of revenue for this? We have discussions of that kind here, and some states have done something like that, but it's not at the national level, for obvious reasons. Well, I don't want to end up taking your entire evening. So are there other areas of incentives like these examples you just given that you wanted to mention before we go on to another couple of questions? And
in terms of incentives, Italy probably is one of the most interesting one because they created the white certificates. It's very, it's a complex system.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is related about the stock exchange of electricity and gas. Some countries have done a similar way. How it works? It works that the utility have some obligations, and this is maybe similar to US, but I mean, they have some obligation in terms to improve the efficiency on the territories, on the end user, their clients. In order to do this, they have some obligations. They have to reach a certain number of TOE per year. let's say, a certain time of ton equivalent oil. And in order to, when they have to, they can do it in two ways. Or they go to buy on the market, which is a market of white certificates, or they do projects that generate white certificates. Every time that you make a project of that saves one TOE, one ton of equivalent oil, you get one certificate.
It's kind of like a carbon tax or carbon trade-off. Yeah, yeah.
Exactly, but it works in a very low scale, something like that. Of course, you need a very, let's say, growing obligations on the utilities that they find a new way in order to do jobs. I mean, ISCO, an energy service company, have been invented in U.S. I mean, it's, there are pretty examples of success stories, and it, we are still looking at them. But now what is happening in EU, due to the high price of electricity, the high price of gas, the pricing policies, the first steps in order to do an energy, let's say, energy efficiency steps, energy or renewables, but especially energy efficiency. So you have the pricing, the incentives now is able to overcome just the a small share of risk, because banks have seen that it started to work, it's feasible. In the Europe has a very important program, it is called Horizon 2020, it's the one that it takes one third of the budget of EU, it's only for innovation and research. And they have a special line only for financing issues in order to how to boost more marketable, how to make energy efficiency more marketable and less dependent on. And also the big financial institutions, the big funds have started to see, oh, this kind of things works after 5 years of statistics. You see that it works. You have some transaction cost because it's problem. It's to how to, the big question is how to aggregate small investments, because maybe in our house we have an investment, so I don't know, of 2,000 euro, the other people 10,000 euro. So you have very micro. But if you look at the type of profile, it's very attracting. So Europe is working a lot on this, and you have some application on this, in which, for instance, this is very interesting. Europe provide a grant, 90% grant, only to aggregate, make energy audit and aggregation of investments. So you make a viable in order that you have a dossier, you know, to present to the bank. You build the relation to the bank, it's a transaction cost. You build the relation for the investor, transaction cost. So all these transaction costs are paid, but you have to guarantee a leverage to the European Bank of Investment of 25. Or in some case, no, let's say that this 25 has been changing in two. One line as 15, one other line as 30. So, a leverage. What does it mean? I give you 1 million of technical assistance. You have to be able to use this 1 million in order to guarantee an investment of 25 million. At the beginning, it seems people, when it started, because it started in 2011, people said, oh, this is crazy. But you have more than 20, 30 cases in Europe where it has been applied. It has been applied in Modena, for instance. Just for example, because it's a competition. Every year, every time, Europe has a certain kind of cities, aggregation of municipalities, local banks, and let's say a certain kind of very matured, you can say in English, matured?
Matured.
Projects, not just early stage.
Yes, mature.
You aggregate, you know already a certain, where is the main things to go. For instance, you have already done an audit of the hospitals. You know already the bills of the street lightings. You know that there are some private companies that are interested. So you put certain, and so you present to the EU, you say, okay, I give you the money. I give you 2 million, you give me 50 million of investments.
That sounds sounds very, very wise and intelligent. I read, I'm kind of doing some research for this program. I read that every single town in Italy has at least one source of renewable energy. Now, I don't know if that was true. It was this was kind of a market analysis of the prospects for investing in Italy. So it sounded to me like it was accurate information. I mean, what kinds of things along the lines of sustainability are being done in Modena or Salerno, the places I guess you'd be the most familiar with? You know, when we were in Foligno, for instance, I noticed a tremendous use of bicycle riding throughout the whole center of the city. People just taking their kids to school and going grocery shopping and commuting to work on bicycles. It was really interesting to see in a city that's not considered one of the spectacular cities of Italy.
I will say something talking about this. I wish I'm not taking too much time because, I mean, there are also interesting things to say about buildings, about Mariarosaria.
Okay, whatever, go ahead.
But I want to say something because, I mean, I take the opportunity, I mean, according to the law, Italian law, this is very particular about Italy, this is from the law of the 91, number 10, every organization with a certain type of thresholds of consumption has to have an energy manager.
Ah, okay.
Today is a certain kind of standard, European standards. Let's say there is the ISO 5001.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, it was already introduced, and it's very in line with the Italian culture of the cities, because our country is a country of, let's say, 100 cities, which is very related to culture and so on. And I wrote an email to the energy manager of my hometown, that is Giancarlo Savino. I used to present this case around many countries of Europe, and I asked Giancarlo, please send me another time the presentation of what you have done in more than, let's say, 20 years, 25 years of career. And it's very impressive because Giancarlo doesn't came from, he came from a city from the south. Usually it's an area where there are less resources and opportunities. And so the things that he did in, let's say, in all this period, it's more, let's say, interesting because he needed to create a certain kind of things with more constraints. What does it mean? That he started, just to give you a very, very few examples, he started to change all the heating plants with the most, let's say, polluting oil of all the schools, let's say 50, 70 schools, and that's gain energy efficiency, less pollution, but also less consumption.
Right, so, right.
Sometimes. Then he started to make information campaign just in the, let's say, in the nursery school and in the primary school. He gets 25,000 euro of discount just explaining to the people how to switch off correctly lighting and other kind of things, managing with establishing a certain kind of, let's say, idea. And then he gained more action, still convinced the mayor in order to make an investment on PV of the dimension of 24 megawatt of power. I mean, the city of Salerno has 150,000. But he invested 24 megawatt when it was costing around, let's say, 3,000. So we are talking about around 100 million of investment. But why it was possible? Why the mayor believed in that? He believed because he has done things, many things, starting from just from the main things, baseline consumption, and then on this I can build up. And I mean, of course, now they are talking about sustainable mobility, that is one of the priority for Europe, and it's become in a city like Modena where we live. I mean, what we can say about bicycle roads?
Well, first we have to say that we live in a planned land.
It helps.
Nice to go on bicycle. It's not always that easy in the Italian territory.
Yeah, with the hill towns. Yes. Yeah.
Exactly. Very diverse. So here, but also in the big city like Milan, Turin, you can find always some kind of public bicycles. And recently, for example, in Milan, for sure. There are also public electric cars, car sharing, electric car sharing. So
the taxi, all the taxis in Modena and Milan are
electric cars.
There are hybrid car or electric car.
And they're car
on model of Toyota in.
And it's car sharing. You're saying that was in Milan and in Modena.
You have car sharing, and you have also the taxi that are using the incentives the taxi driver in order to get
a hybrid car.
Some of them were more courage and take a completely power electric car.
So
it is becoming also more visible things, and people started to think it's a very intelligent way because people started to.
Right.
Reflect because I use the taxi, I see how it works, and I talk to the taxi driver.
So there's the educational component happens at the same time. Well, I think this program has a certain time limit. So, Maria, did you want to say something else in terms of building, relative to buildings?
A new law was approved at the beginning of this year for public buildings. I don't know how to translate literally, but it's like the minimum environmental criteria for design and planning. So first, you can choose to follow or not, it depends from the cases, how to make your project sustainable. Now, with this law, you have to, from the first steps of the project, to follow some criteria and to demonstrate also with calculation and with some simulations to respect some criteria in terms of transmission, but also in terms of life cycles of materials, for example. You have to demonstrate that material you're using for the building has a percentage of recycled material. So this is really important because it's a challenge for architects and for engineers, but it's it will really make the change. Because we now have to deal with this law, and from the beginning we have to think differently to the project. So all the choices we do are conditioned by this criteria.
Yes.
So this is really nice thing.
And I didn't understand clearly at the beginning. This is the Italian at the state level, the national level, or is it the region? So this is now. Going to be required by law to meet these standards, and
public buildings.
Right. So all public buildings.
Usually, you always start with public.
Right.
Then you started to make a promotion for new.
Right.
And you start with obligation for everyone.
I was going to ask you about that. So beyond public buildings, maybe this is the last question. Are there energy and sustainability guidelines that are in building codes for buildings that aren't public buildings in Italy? Other than the incentives we talked about, are there things in the building code in the laws that require certain minimum levels of, certain maximum energy consumption, certain kind of materials, insulation, that kind of thing?
Yes, there are. It's not really like, okay, you have to choose this material instead of this other one. But there are some values that you have to respect. And of course, only some materials satisfy that standards. So basically, this law is also driving the market because if you have to mandatory satisfy this criteria, you have to choose, you have to look for these new materials. For instance, we are working on something and one of these criteria is about the roof. You have to guarantee a certain percentage of solar reflection. And so only few materials have these this characteristic. So that's really important. But the criteria are given by the law now, and there are the minimum ones. So every public building must respect them.
You describe for public buildings sounds very similar to what we have in this country, which is LEED, which is a voluntary.
Actually, that's the difference, because in LEED you can choose which criteria you follow, right?
Right, yeah.
Here you cannot choose. You have to satisfy all the criteria.
Yeah, no, I think it's wonderful. It's what we're pushing for here. So, all right, well, I appreciate you taking the time to participate in this interview. Wonderful to see you both. I think that would be the end of our interview. So that, anyway.
Thank you.
The rest we won't. Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Building Green is supported by BARTA.